What up, bros, and welcome to the All Bros Podcast. I am Jonathan.
And I'm Caleb.
And I almost forgot that line, even though I've said it over 200 times.
Just what, your name?
No, just the what up, bros. I try to, like, do
it. It up.
That's no, funny thing about that, I was going to go, like, bros, up is what? But then, like, I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. And then I'm like, wait, shit, what is it again? Oh, yeah, it's what up, bros. I had a freaking brain fart.
Dude, that's the worst.
And it shouldn't be a brain fart for that shit, for how many freaking times we've said that. But anyway, welcome to the All Bros Podcast. We are a couple of aspiring filmmakers that love to watch and critique movies, but also enjoy a lot of bit of the nerd life. This week on the podcast, we got one huge release in 4K Spotlight, and I may or may not have pre-ordered this movie twice. Just saying. No chance. Yeah, yeah. See, Caleb gets it. We don't have anything for Through the Wall, unfortunately. And then, so after 4K Spotlight, we'll be moving on to our All Bros headliner of the evening, which will be our breakdown of Scream, which should have been called Scream 5, but whatever. They're going off the Halloween trend.
Yeah.
Is this how it's going to be now?
Dude, who knows? I feel like we need to specify, and this is like Scream 2022.
Yeah. Dude, you know what's funny? So, I don't know if you saw, and I guess we could have talked about this, but I don't really know the Texas Chainsaw Massacre franchise that well.
I don't know it that well either.
Okay. So, I heard in the trailer, the new trailer for the movie coming to Netflix, it's like the girl, I don't know what girl it is, but she's just, I think she talks about how, he's coming back after like 40 years, and, you know, I've been preparing, and everyone's just like, yeah, I'm getting like major Laurie Strode vibes from this, from Halloween 2018. It seems like they kind of just copy and pasted.
Ah, that's disappointing.
Like, even there's a clip that shows like newspaper clippings of what happened for that massacre, and then I think like in the middle.
Wait, in
is...
her space?
What? I it's think like, so. Yeah, I think it's in her space.
It's like, and then suddenly she's this killer.
But then I think in the middle is plastered like a drawing of Leatherface, and everyone was just like, "That is straight up out of Halloween H2O." I'm like, yeah, you're not wrong. So they Gosh. Took it, they took oh my god, what's the word? What the hell is the word? Not influence, I guess.
I think the word you're looking for is plagiarized.
Yeah, there we go. That's a better word. They plagiarized two Halloween films, not one, but two.
Dude,
and two different timelines at that.
Good hell. Dude, I might watch that. Is it a show or is it a movie?
I think it's a movie.
Okay, if it's a movie, I think I'm going to watch that just to see how much shit they rip off.
How many Laurie Strode comparisons or parallels you can point out. Because I'll fully admit, I actually, like, a lot of people, like, hate how they've dealt with Laurie Strode in this new timeline. They're just like, oh, come on, it happened 40 years ago, she should be over it. I'm just like, people, this shit will F you up for life for, like, what she went through. Like, I'm sorry, like, I know she, you know, like, I know some people are just like, oh, yeah, you know, she only, Michael Myers only killed 5 people that night. Why is she being affected by this so bad? It's not like it was a, you know, like, 20 people were killed. It's like, a lot of people were still killed. That can really F someone up. For I don't know how long. Shit. It affects people in different ways. And unfortunately for Lori, it literally effed her up so bad, it basically drove her to be like, yeah, if this effer ever gets out, even 40 years later, I'm prepared.
Yeah, so that comes out February 18th. Should we do that?
Dude, I'm down. But we got to read up on the other lore, because I've never seen.
The first one's on Amazon.
Oh, hell yeah. Okay.
Yeah. So we definitely need to watch the first one. And
okay. Hopefully it's like Halloween 2018, where literally you only needed to watch the original and then And then the newest one.
Yeah. Holy shit. Dude, there are so many freaking...
Oh, yeah, dude, there are. There are many Texas Chainsaw Massacre films.
Yeah, there's the first... There are the original one. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Next Generation. Texas Chainsaw, Leatherface. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, 2003. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Beginning, from 2006.
Jeez.
And then I'm assuming the official Texas Chainsaw Massacre in... From 86 or second one. There's so many. I need to figure out what. Okay, yeah. We definitely need to figure out what we need to watch.
Yeah,
to and then we'll talk about the new one.
Dude, hell yeah. I'm down. Cool. I've always wanted to watch the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre. So,
yeah,
not saying I needed an excuse, but now I got one.
Hell yeah. I mean, hell, we've been trying to figure out what the hell to release, like, or at least that's, for February, because we only have this one and Ron Goes Wrong for next week.
Yeah, it's kind of a dry month.
A little bit, so I think that definitely gives us something to do for the 28th.
Dude, sorry, I know I keep going off topic, but have you seen the reviews for Jackass Forever?
No.
Dude, they are so positive.
Well, of course,
it's a movie. That's true. But no, like, dude, I forget who said it, but someone's just like, it's the same, you know, dick jokes and, you know, sad stunts. Well, not sad stunts, but like crazy stunts, and that's why it's so effing great. It's like the world needed this right now. But freaking IGN gave it a 9, and they're just like, Jackass Forever hopefully is the last one for these guys' sakes, and if it is, it ends it perfectly on a bitter note. Or not a bitter note, a sweet note.
Dude, I'm so excited to go see
this. Dude, I don't want to... The way that they're talking about this movie, I better not freaking cry in a Jackass film.
That would be super sad.
Hey, I got close with Jackass 3, so shut up.
Are you shitting me?
Dude, when... Okay, at the... Okay, in my defense, in the end credits, when they're showcasing, like, when they first started in Jackass, and they're, like, showing, like old photos of themselves, and they're playing Memories by Weezer, yeah. It's a very sweet moment, where you're just like, God damn, I've been watching you guys for a long time, and I'm about to get a little teary-eyed.
Good hell.
Shut up. I'm an emotional person, okay? So kiss my ass. Anyway, before Caleb disses on me anymore, what do you say we get started?
I say, let's do it.
Every day, we're surrounded by media. Books, movies, art, music, games, apps, podcasts, etc., etc. With this constant bombardment, it's easy to miss great media gems in the chaos. But fret not, you've come to the right place, my friend. I'm Jason, and I love media. I invite you to check out the Mixed Media Forest podcast, the podcast where I trudge through the forests of media to find hidden gems for you, the listener. Every episode of Mixed Media Forest is chock full of fun, reviews, nostalgia, positivity, news, rants, stories, and recommendations about all things media. Again, that's the Mixed Media Forest podcast, created on Anchor Podcasting app and available everywhere fine podcasts can be found. Give it a listen. It's what all the cool kids are doing.
All right, so with 4K Spotlight this week, coming to 4K, which I feel this is like, goddamn, that was very fast, is Encanto.
It does feel like that, but I think they gave it the 45 days.
It came out November 24th in theaters.
Yeah, so.
Okay, yeah, so 4 months, about that. That's the new norm. It used to be 5 months, I remember, but now, yeah, it's only like, hell, sometimes it's even only 3 months.
November 24th? you said?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it came out on Thanksgiving Day.
That's 70 days.
Oh. Okay, that's... Wow, okay, never mind. Okay.
So
not even 3 months.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, I mean, I'm not upset by that. I actually...
No, I'm not either.
I feel like I prefer that.
That's fair. Well, because, dude, for how fast, like, movies, like, leave theaters now, it's insane. Like I told you, like, you know, before COVID, movies would stay in theaters for usually about three months, sometimes four, depending on how well it was doing. And I'll fully admit, you know, like, there are movies that are sticking around in movie theaters for quite a while, and I feel Spider-Man No Way Home is going to be one of those.
Oh, yeah, for sure. They're going to cash in on that for as long as they can.
Yeah, but I feel like...
Especially since Sony doesn't have a streaming service.
That is true. But yeah, since, you know, Disney has Disney Plus, they're shortening the window so much if they decide to release something in theaters now. Like, it was only out for a month before, because it went to Disney Plus on Christmas Eve, and you didn't even need to pay extra for it. You just had to have a Disney Plus subscription.
Yeah. I'm honestly not upset by that, because it's like, it's so hard as a parent of a young child to even go out and see movies. And that's just like if you want to go see one yourself, like going to take them to a theater, I can't even imagine how difficult that must be. And so being able to have that option to do it all at home, and all you have to do is wait an extra month, like that's worth it to me.
No, that's fair. I mean, like, I can't really say anything because I didn't try to go see Encanto in a in theaters, which I
shit,
really
man,
have.
No one did.
I mean, yeah, unfortunately, yeah, I think it grossed like two. God, I forget how much it grossed, but thankfully, it's finding its voice on Disney Plus. It's been a huge success on Disney Plus, thank God.
Shit, and TikTok.
Yep, and TikTok, and you know, people buying the soundtrack like it's like crazy. Freaking they!
Holy shit!
Dude, I don't want to know how many people have bought We Don't Talk About Bruno from iTunes.
The number would probably blow our minds.
yeah, you know what? It probably would.
But yeah, like, it's just, the older my child gets, the more willing I would be to take them to a movie, like a brand new Disney movie. But I probably wouldn't reach that age until, like, maybe 7 or 8.
No, it's fair.
Like, or at least until they could show that they could sit still for a couple hours.
Yeah, dude, I want to thank you for being a parent that doesn't bring their, like, super young child that might start crying. I'm not saying Iris would. I don't think she would. But, you know, we all know that, you know, crying children during a movie is definitely not a fun experience, and it takes you out of it.
Dude, no shit. Dude, I was ready. Did I tell you about the lady who brought, or the couple who brought their, like, couple-week-old child to Spider-Man in IMAX?
Yeah, you did. Yeah, that's bullshit.
Yeah, and they almost sat in front of me, and I was going to lose my mind.
You're just like, that'll do it. That'll do it.
Yeah, but luckily they freaking moved to, like, the front row, so I'm
thank God.
Good.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, so, yeah, it's just, it'd be a while before I felt comfortable doing that. And even
no,
with, like...
No, completely understandable.
Like, I would take a 7-year-old alone, but, like, assuming that I have another one, like, I'm not going to take 2 children under the age of 7 to a movie.
That's understandable. I get that.
Like, I will wait until I am sure that they can sit still for a couple hours to watch a movie.
At least an hour and a half. That's all I ask.
Yeah, like, it will get to the point where I will test them. Like, there will be a test that they will not know that they are taking. Like, I will sit down, I will turn on a movie, and if they talk, move, or do whatever, like, other than going to the bathroom.
Okay.
Yeah, then, nope. Like,
guess and you failed.
Time. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Love it. I love it.
If it gets to the point where they're like 9 or 10, I'll be like, okay, listen, this is the test, and you have failed it every single time since you were like 5.
Come on, guys. Come on, kids. Step it up.
Yeah. Like, right now, when she, like, until she's 5, I will not consider it. Because I do know that there are 5-year-olds that can sit through a movie, so I will do my assessment when she is 5. And I will continue to do it until she passes.
I like it. I love the system.
And it has to be, like, serious movies, too. Like, it can't be just, like, kiddie movies.
Like how serious we talking here?
Not like, I'm not talking like Schindler's List or anything.
Okay.
I'm talking like an Avengers level movie. Like, okay. I will not take a young child to an Avengers level movie until they can sit quietly for a couple hours.
Fair enough.
And then same thing with like one of these Disney movies. Like Encanto, like any other future movie, like they will have to prove themselves before we go to a movie theater together.
All right. Yeah. You know. Fair enough.
Yeah. I'm just on the team that I prefer to watch these movies at home or have the access to them at home. And it shows that it works, because this movie went from, like, no one talking about it to everyone talking about it.
Oh, yeah. That's true. I'll fully admit, I'm sure my opinion will change when, I'm not single as fuck. but as for now...
The explicit marker that we need.
I'm sorry.
Dude, are you apologizing? I can do that. I put the explicit on all of our episodes.
Okay, good.
Or at least I try to. Like, I don't know if that shows up.
But I'll fully admit, it is nice being able to enjoy these movies at home and not having to worry about... Because you know what? Honestly, I'll fully admit, the past couple movies, they kind of have been bad theater experiences. Just the people that sit next to me.
Yeah, it doesn't happen in VR, does it?
I mean, when I have to sit next to this asshole, yeah. I'm just kidding.
You love it and you know it.
I do, very much so. It's,
We just need to get Vic and DJ in on it.
Dude, that would be the coolest bros movie night ever.
Yeah, are you kidding me? Like, that'd be
all
sick.
Four of us together? Oh, that would be incredible.
3 different time zones?
Yeah,
might That'd be the shit.
Yeah, that wouldn't be too hard to work around, right? I mean, we've done it before with the podcast.
That is very true. Guys, go get a headset.
Yeah. Wink, wink,
wink, wink.
But anyway, so Encanto is I feel my accent is so bad. Like, I don't know, I feel like I'm not doing it justice if I just say Encanto. I feel like I have to say Encanto.
I mean, your accent's fine. Like, okay, that one's not a hard word to say.
Okay, cool. Okay, phew. So, Encanto is getting a regular Blu-ray and 4K release. No shocker there. But it is getting, I think, 3 exclusives? I don't think there's a 4th one.
Oh, damn.
Yeah. Oh, wait, there is. Okay, so first up, actually, there is 4. I'm sorry. That's kind of a plain cover. Well, okay, so the first one is a Disney movie club exclusive. So if you guys are part of the Disney movie club, you guys can get an exclusive Blu-ray cover. That's literally the only thing that's special about this. Because the 4K and Blu-ray are the exact same cover art as each other, and it's literally just the main poster. But this new one actually has them in the house, or in the casita. So, I mean, that's cool, but I'm not part of the Disney Movie Club, so I will not be getting that, and I'm not going to pay up the ass to, like, get it for eBay prices, because it's just a freaking different slipcover, even though if it was, like, exclusive to another store, I probably would buy it. But since it's Disney Movie Club, probably not going to do it unless, like, it, like, someone actually had it for, like, $20 actually on eBay, which I doubt that's going to happen. People are probably going to be charging $40-$50 for it.
Jeez.
And to you, I say screw you. That's all I'm going to say. So the other three exclusives with Walmart, and this is, like, honestly, I feel this is more, I don't know if this is more boring than a different cover, but I don't know, I just feel this is boring. So it's just the regular 4K cover, but you get an exclusive pin that is of the casita.
I mean, I feel like there's been worse.
No, that's fair. I mean, I think this is a trend that Walmart is starting, because next week's release, which I don't want to spoil it, also does the same thing with their Walmart exclusive.
With a pin?
Yeah.
Dumb.
So, I'm excited to see what Caleb thinks with that one for next week.
Dude, they have, like, people who do covers have such an opportunity to just go freaking hog wild.
It's true. It's very true.
Like, does it have a steelbook?
Yes, it does.
Is the steelbook cover cool?
Oh, yeah. I love the steelbook.
All right, talk about that, because I have an idea for what I would have done for the steelbook.
Okay. So, the steelbook, which I'm pretty sure pre-orders have already sold out. Shocker. You know what? I think I've already said this in, like, the Halloween, when we talked about, like, Halloween Kills or, like, the week after. I see, like, people in the comments for these releases being like, oh my god, it was not even available release day. I can't believe that it sold out that fast. Best Buy, you need to take control of, like, your quantity. And I'm just like, okay, first of all, Best Buy is not, what's the word? In charge of the quantity they get sent. They are only in charge of distributing that exclusive. The company is the one that distributes the how many they're given. And two, usually most of these steelbooks are up for pre-order shortly after they are released in theaters. So you literally have months to pre-order it.
Hmm.
So, I don't know. I get annoyed when people bitch about, oh, it wasn't available on release day. And it pisses me off. And I'm just like, if you're a collector, you should know that with steelbooks, and considering it says limited edition collectible steelbook, you should know that that's something you should pre-order. But that's just my two cents.
No, it's true. Like, if something says exclusive, you don't get a bitch about it not being there.
Yeah, because I've had, like, what was it, a couple months ago with the Who Framed Roger Rabbit steelbook, I didn't pre-order it. Stupid decision, because it's sold out and it's never come back into stock.
Yeah, sucks to suck.
Yeah. But so with the Encanto steelbook, it doesn't show what is on the back, unfortunately. But I have a feeling it's probably gonna. I feel it's gonna be either someone's door or the door that's, like, at the end where it has all of them on it.
Okay.
I would love that.
So what's the front?
The front is just, like, kind of like a wide shot of the house. I don't know. I like it. And then the inside, when you open it up, is just a family shot of all of them in the casita.
See, I would have done that backwards. I would have personally put the the picture of all of them together on the cover, putting like a really wide, just like a shot of the house, kind of like what I'm assuming the pin looks like on the back, and then done. Oh wait, yeah, and then on the inside done like the entire house with like the people actually like in front of it.
Okay. I mean, that's literally how the regular 4K cover is it's the house in the background and then they're all in the front.
Yeah, I would have done that on the inside.
All right.
Just because, like, it is basic, but I don't feel like you need anything super fancy inside.
That's fair.
Like, all my designs would be very, like, front-focused.
Well, and I feel that's how it should be, because, you know, that's the thing you see when you buy this product. You can't see the back, because all of the information is covering it up.
Yeah. Oh, I know what I would have done. Okay, on the inside, I would have done, like, a wide shot of the house, and then instead of, like, what I said on the back, I would put one of the glowing butterflies.
Ooh. Yeah, I like that.
Just to keep the color scheme the same on the steelbook.
Yeah, Disney, listen to Caleb.
Do it.
All right, and then the final exclusive, which I also pre-ordered this one as well. So I pre-ordered the steelbook and this Target exclusive. That includes limited edition lithographs. Which I can't, it doesn't really, doesn't show exactly what they are, at least from what I see, but it says featuring Colombian artist collaborations, inspired by Encanto.
That's sick.
So, yeah. Right. But I mean, the cover art is different too, cause it's, Maribel, I can't even say her name in like a accent. Maribel, I'm just gonna go with it. It's her in front, like smack dab in the front, the house behind her, and then all of the family is spread out throughout the house. So you see, like, Abuela in one window, Felix and Pepe in another, Luisa in one, Dolores in one. Oh my God. Camilo and another. How am I forgetting these names? Isabella in the next one. Antonio has his own one. And then all the way at the bottom is, Julieta and, God damn it. What's, Maribel's, father's name?
Augustine,
thank you. So they are in the last window. So I like it. It's different.
That sounds super cool.
Yeah. So yeah, I will officially have two copies of Encanto. Am I ashamed? No, because I freaking love this movie.
It was a great movie. If you guys haven't listened to our breakdown of that, go check it out.
Yes, because it's a great breakdown.
Yes, it is.
But yeah, so that's it for 4K Spotlight. Definitely pick up Encanto when it comes out on 4K and Blu-ray tomorrow.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. So, Caleb, what do you say we move on to our headliner of the evening?
I say, let's do it!
Alright, so with this week's All Bros headliner, we will be breaking down Scream 2022. Caleb, would you like to let everyone know how we break down movies on this podcast?
I would love to. If you are new to our breakdown system, we have split movies into 8 different categories that we individually individually score to come to a final All Bros letter grade. The eight categories that we score are story, writing, acting, character development, effects, music, costumes, and then we give it our own personal grade at the very end. With this being a horror movie, though, we will be swapping out character development for logic. Like, whether or not that this horror movie actually, like, follows the rules that it sets in place. So, with that, if you have not seen Scream 2022, it is about to get all types of spoiled for you. So, you are
warned. Turn away now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, without all further ado, reading with Rose, everyone.
All right, let's see how I do with this one. All right, 25 years after Billy Loomis and Stu Matt... How do I not know how to say his last name? Matcher? How would... M-A-C-H-E-R.
Yeah, or... Yeah, Matcher.
Matcher? Okay. And Stu Matcher terrorized the town of Woodsboro. A high school student named Tara Carpenter is home alone when she is attacked by Ghostface and left hospitalized. Out of town, Tara's estranged older sister, Sam Carpenter, is informed by Wes Hicks, one of Tara's friends, about her sister's attack. Sam returns to Woodsboro with her boyfriend Richie to visit Tara at the hospital, where Sam is reunited with Tara's friend group, Wes, Amber Freeman, twins Chad and Mindy, Meeks Martin, and Liv McKenzie. Liv's summer fling, Vince Schneider, who is later revealed to be Stu Matcher's nephew, is next to be killed by Ghostface. After Sam's arrival at the hospital, she is attacked by Ghostface and tells her sister, Tara, that she has been dealing with hallucinations of Billy Loomis. Sam then tells Tara that Billy is her biological father after discovering the truth years prior, which resulted in their parents' separation and why Sam became estranged from her. The next day, Sam and Richie pay Dewey Riley a visit, who has been depressed since his divorce from Gail Weathers. The pair ask for his help in stopping the killer, and he later contacts Sidney Prescott and Gail, warning them about the return of Ghostface. Dewey then joining the teens at Mindy and Chad's home. Dewey then joining the teens at Mindy and Chad's home and is reunite. Shouldn't it say joins the teens?
Yes.
Yeah, Dewey then joins the teens at Mindy and Chad's home. His help in stopping the... Okay, this sentence is, like, effing me up. It's his help in stopping the killer, and he later... Oh, wait. Oh, my God. I was going back to the sentence before. I'm so sorry. Wow. Okay, I'm going to start that sentence over, and God, this is, like, the best episode of Reading with Rose ever, isn't it? Dewey then joining the teens at Mindy and Chad's home... and is reunited, I still believe it should have been joined, and is reunited with the twins' mother, Martha, the sister of the late Randy Meeks. With the three attacks being on people related in some capacity to the original killers, Sam is accused of being the killer. Ghostface then murders Wes and his mother, Sheriff Judy Hicks, at their house. There, Dewey reunites with Gail, who has arrived in town to cover the story. At the hospital, Tara and Richie are attacked by Ghostface, but are saved by Dewey and Sam. Dewey is next to be killed when he attempts to finish off Ghostface. Sidney arrives in town after finding out about Dewey's death and meets up with both Gail and Sam at the hospital. Sidney asks Sam to help take down the killer, but Sam declines, choosing to leave town with both Richie and Tara instead. Sam, Richie, and Tara are about to leave Woodsboro, but are forced to stop at Amber's house to retrieve an extra inhaler for Tara. Sidney and Gail follow them to Amber's house after leaving a tracking device on their car, which is then revealed to be Stu's old house, where the original events took place. There, twins Chad and Mindy are both attacked and stabbed by Ghostface, but they survive their attacks. As Sam tends to an injured Mindy, Amber pulls out a gun and shoots Liv in the head, revealing herself as one of the killers. When Gail and Sidney arrive, Amber fakes being injured, a stunt that neither of them believe, leading to Amber shooting and injuring Gail. Richie then stabs Sam and reveals himself to be the last killer. Richie and Amber both take Sam, Sidney, and Gail into the kitchen, where their motives for the killings are revealed. that they are in fact super fans of the Stab film series, which had adapted the previous Ghostface killing sprees as films before switching to original stories after running out of massacres to adapt, who met on Reddit. Disappointed in the trajectory taken with the most recent film, Rian Johnson's Stab 8, adapting Charlie Walker's and Jill Roberts' massacre with fictionalized elements, they decided to embark on a new killing spree, bringing back the original cast to provide new and improved source material for a future requel Stab film. Richie seduced Sam on Amber's behalf in precedence of their killing spree in order to frame her for the killings after the fact due to Billy being her father, so they could remain free to commit further killing sprees. Breaking free, Gail then shoots Amber, who lands on the stove and is lit aflame. Sam is injured, but a hallucination of Billy points her to Amber's knife on the floor, thus saving her life, and she uses it to stab Richie multiple times before shooting him. A badly burned Amber attempts to attack the group again, but is shot dead by Tara. Tara and the Meeks twins are taken to the hospital, and Sam thanks Sydney and Gail for their help before deciding to stop taking her antipsychotic medication. Gail refuses to write about the new murders because she doesn't want to give the killers notoriety and prefers to let them die anonymity. Did I say that right?
You mean anonymity?
God, what the hell is English language to me? You know what? I'm skipping over the word. Caleb said it right and you guys heard it. She plans to write a touching tribute to Dewey instead.
Oh.
Dude. Reading with Rose, everybody. that was appropriate.
All right. This was really good.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, like, I had my doubts if they could pull off a Scream 5 ever since that they announced it, especially without making it with Wes Craven being involved, rest in peace. I was very scared to see if they could pull it off, but oh my god, they did it incredibly in spades, trifold. So good.
This was really, really well executed. I always love how they're very self-aware about what they're doing with just with the movie in general, like how the first one just talked about how more horror movies go and like the classic horror movie trope, and then the second one started talking about how sequels work, and then how you conclude a trilogy in the third, and then they're like, oh, and then we bring it back in number four. And then this one, just calling it a requel.
Yeah, I love that. Yeah, like what Caleb said, like Scream 4 focused on remakes. This one focuses on what kind of basically, I guess, kind of reboots in a way, kind of like what with Halloween 2018 did. You go back to the basics, you bring back original players, and you go from there.
Yeah, and it's hard to argue, because it's like, it does work.
Oh yeah, very nicely.
Yeah, and this movie just proved that. Like, they brought in, like, all of the key players from the original. I mean, they brought back Sydney, Gail, and Dewey, and surprisingly, they even brought back Billy.
Oh, that was the original actor?
That was the original actor.
Holy shit, I didn't know that.
Yep. Like, I just checked.
Dude, that's awesome.
Yeah, Skeet Ulrich. And I just checked his IMDb, and he is most known for playing Billy in Scream.
That is so cool they brought him back for this.
And de-aged him, because he looks older than he did in this movie.
Okay, yeah.
But holy shit, did they pull that off so well?
They did.
Which we will get into with effects.
Yes.
Most definitely. But yeah, like I loved some of the new cast in this. I really liked Tara and I really liked Sam. Wes was alright. Mindy and Chad were a bit much. Liv was way too much. And then Amber was very excessive. And then I really liked Richie too. Like I felt he was really good, and then he just kind of got crazy near the end. But
Richie was the boyfriend, right?
Yes.
I feel that's kind of like a that, I don't
like,
know.
It
I
had
feel
to. Like
yeah,
it
that kind of just what happens at the end of the Scream movies when it's showcase who the killer is.
Nuts.
Yeah, because dude, like Scream 4, Emma Roberts, she goes like freaking psycho when they freaking reveal that she's the killer, and I swear she has one of the best lines in the whole Scream franchise when she goes to the hospital where Sydney is, and she's just like, "Well, you just won't die, will you? What are you? Who are you, fucking Michael Myers?"
Dude, oh my gosh, like. I have noticed that. Like, they just go freaking hog wild once they're, like, exposed.
Which, you know, fair enough. I mean, you know, once you don't have to hide anymore, it's just like, might as well be insane. Everyone's gonna think I am when they find out I'm the killer, so.
I love how they kept, like, all the, like, the character building that they've done with the original cast. Like, Dewey, for example, like, in this one, he felt like he was very competent.
Yes.
Whereas, like, in the first, like, I'd say two, he was very, like, played for laughs.
Like, honestly, it's amazing. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, like, which I appreciated. Like, he had, like, some wisdom about him in this.
Yes. I absolutely agree. Like, I love seeing the comparison of this Dewey compared to how he was in Scream 4, where, you know, he was the sheriff. Him and Gale were, they were pretty sure they were married still in Scream 4.
Yes.
Yeah. So, like, honestly, like, I feel in Scream 4, he was on cloud 9. You know, very, very happy at his dream job. He had, you know, dream wife, you know, he was happy. Whereas with, you know, Scream 5, Scream 2022, whatever you want to call it, you know, he is, you know, divorced from Gale. He was asked to step down as the sheriff of Woodsboro. And it's honestly, like, really cool to see, like, how badly that affects him.
Yeah, like, it just, it kind of had the same feeling, like, oh, shit, what's his name from Stranger Things?
Hawkins?
Was it Hawkins? Yeah.
David Harbour's character?
Yeah.
Yeah, Hawkins.
Yeah, kind of like that feeling, like, just kind of has that deadbeat life going on, and then finally finds, like, a rejuvenated purpose with the Ghostface killing, or with Ghostface coming back. Like, I love that. And then Sydney and Gale, like, just showing that they were not putting up with anyone's shit.
Yeah.
Like, Sydney's just saying, like, killer or not, you better reveal yourself. And then she just, like, walks up to a door and just shoots.
Yeah. Dude, I love how, like, when she's talking to the killer, she's just like, all right, I'm getting bored. I'm hanging up.
Or something. Yeah. Dude, like, my two favorite scenes was, like, right after Amber was revealed, and then she comes out screaming, "He's in there! He's in there!" And then Gale and Sydney just, like, look at each other, like, "We're not falling for this, are we?" And they're like, "Nope," and she's just like, "Shit!" Everyone, like, shoots and runs back in. And then what made me, feel like Richie, because it tricked me, because I was very suspicious of Richie for a majority of the movie. I'm just like, okay, like, I didn't think like Reddit or anything like that, but I was just thinking, okay, there's probably like some like message board that they could have met on, or and he kind of like set this up, blah 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 blah, like whatever. But when he was in the bathroom and Sydney freaking shot, and then he's just like, she's just like, I told you, like, like, why didn't you listen, bitch?
Dude, yeah, like,
so, and he's just like, you had a gun. I'm like, you know what? He's not wrong.
Yeah,
I wouldn't come out either. I'm like, I probably would have hid better. Yeah.
Honestly, I don't know why. There's one line from Sydney, and I might actually save that for writing. Yeah, I'll save that for writing.
Okay. Oh, but the way that they shared the story, and it felt like they kind of went back to the original, because with the first one, when Drew Barrymore's character is killed, is she part of the stab movie?
Or no.
She's like the first.
Yeah, she's the actual first like real killing. The stab movies don't come in until Scream 2.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure.
Very good.
But it kind of, like, what I was about to say, that it felt like they were going back to their roots there. Not, because I was straight up expecting, like, when the Scream title came on, right after Tara got, like, stabbed, I was straight up just expecting to see stab whatever number they were on.
Dude, same.
I was just like, all right, like, here's another stab movie, and then they're like, Scream, and I'm like, oh, okay.
All right, I'm bringing it back to the original, I like it.
Hell yeah, and then, like, I love that. I love that she didn't, like, die either, even though I feel like she probably should have.
Dude, like, I compare her wounds to how, remember, Officer Hawkins in Halloween, how he gets run over. He first gets stabbed, and then the doctor runs him over.
Yep.
Yeah. So originally, as far as I know, he was supposed to be dead. Like, that was the end of Hawkins, but everyone was just like, oh no, he can't be dead. He's a fan favorite. You know, we all love him. So they decide to bring him back. Yeah, I'm sorry. I call bullshit. After getting stabbed in the neck and run over, he would have been dead.
Dude, the shit. Like, I want to know, like, realistically, if people can survive those wounds. Because I know people, like, it's more likely to survive a stabbing. Like, no matter how much you don't want to.
Yeah.
Like, I know it's possible. Like, I know full well that it's possible to survive a stabbing. Getting stabbed that much, though?
Yeah. Yeah, Ghostface was freaking going to town.
Yeah, no shit. I'm like when they're just like, dude, like, okay, when Sam was on the phone with what's his face, Wes, and he's like, you need to get over here, and I was like, oh shit, like, Tara's dead.
And yeah, I thought the same
like,
thing.
Oh no, she's alive, and I'm like, what? And they're like, oh, she's awake, and I'm like,
bullshit.
Yeah, I'm like,
it's like, she's got to be in a coma. Like, come on.
Yeah, like, what? Oh, shit. What did Richie call her? A freaking pincushion?
Yeah, I think so. Rightfully so.
Yeah, I was like, shit, man. Like, that was insane.
Huh.
But, oh my gosh. That was wild. The whole thing was wild.
Yeah, it was such a fun roller coaster. That's how I best describe this movie. Just, it was a wonderful nod to the original film and all of the films before it. It really honors the franchise. So yeah, I love this story so much.
Yeah, one of my favorite things that they, or another one of my favorite things that they did when they went to kill Wes. And the way that he got out of the shower and was just, like, kept opening doors and then, like, they had it positioned like they were going to do, like, oh, he shuts the door and then Ghostface is standing, like, right there. They did that, what, like, how, like, five times?
Yeah, dude, it was so many.
It started getting funny. And then, like, when he went to the door, like, the front door, I was expecting him to open it and see his mom, but, like, no, he just, like, shut the door and closed it and then turns around and Ghostface is there. I'm like, freaking, like, because they managed to get me off my guard by doing it that
many
times. Yeah,
dude, they were so, dude, that, honestly, that is probably, like, kind of the grossest kill, in my opinion. Dude, it literally, when Ghostface stabs him in the neck, you actually see it go through his neck on the side. I'm like, ugh. I'm like, no, I don't want to see that.
Yeah.
I'm fine if it goes all the way in, but don't be coming out the side.
Oh my, dude, you know what I almost lost my mind over?
What?
I was seriously expecting it to, like, slowly, like, him to, like, slowly pull it out. Yeah, so it, like, goes in his neck, but kind of cockeyed, so it's, like, halfway through, and then it's just, like, he was pushing it, right?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
So he was pushing it, like, deeper in, and that was hard to watch. That was so hard to watch.
Do you have a favorite death in this movie?
Ooh. That is honestly a really tough one.
I find it so funny that we talk about this kind of stuff with horror movies. It's like, oh, dude, did you have, like, a favorite way that someone died? Yeah. What's your favorite kill?
That's hard. I had my favorite, like, attempted. My favorite attempted was Mindy when she was, like, watching the first stab movie and she's just like, just turn around. And, like, and then Ghostface is literally behind her. And then she, like, gosh, these people just don't turn around. And then she, like, pauses and then looks.
Oh, yeah. And she's then, like, oh, shit.
Dude, I laughed my ass off. I'm like, that. Ooh. Oh my gosh, like, like, just the way that she was freaking, it was kind of like this situation with freaking Wes. Like, he's going to close the door, and, yeah, he's going to close the door, and then Ghostface is going to be, like, right there. Oh, not that time, this time. Nope, not that time, this time. And then, so, like, I'm like, shit, she's going to get stabbed and not turn around. Yeah, anyone want to know why my couch is pushed up against the back wall? That's why.
Dude, I've never understood people that put their couches in, like, the middle of their living rooms. I'm like, no, it's got to be pushed up all the way against a wall. Because of these exact, yeah, if you've watched horror movies, especially as many as me and Caleb have, yeah, you pick up on some things of how not to decorate your house.
Yeah, no joke. We're not fans of the open floor concept. We're fans of our lives.
Yep, exactly.
Guess what? No one's hiding behind us. Dude, I've always hated that. Like, anytime my mom's, like, reorganized, like, a room and had, like that kind of situation where the couch is in the middle, like, there's never been one time where someone hasn't come behind me and tried to scare me.
Oh yeah, dude, I remember when your mom, like, set it up. Yeah, she set up the couches to where it kind of looked like a movie theater. Yeah, freaking Bronson would always jump up from behind one, scare the shit out of you.
Yeah.
Or maybe not scare the shit out of you, more so attempt to.
Yeah, like, yeah. But still, like, the thought was there.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like, ever since then, I've always been a fan of putting my couch up against the wall.
Smart man.
But, yeah, so that was my favorite attempted, and it was just because she was, like, losing her mind, like, turn around. And then, like, turning around. I think the weakest probably had to be her brother, Chad.
That's fair.
Like, because his was just, like, as basic can be.
Yeah, literally gets stabbed, runs, starts running away, and Ghostface chases him.
Yeah. But my favorite kill, like, that's hard, because I think I'd have to give it to Wes, because just because of the way that they did that, like, just the hiding, or kind of making fun of the whole behind-the-door trick.
It was a great setup like, for a really good kill.
Yeah. Like, it's super hard to, like, pick a death, because there weren't very many.
That's, yeah. Yeah, Ghostface, I will say he definitely ain't no Michael Myers.
Yeah, he dropped the ball.
did I don't know if you, well, yeah, I don't think you've checked out the extras, but have you, there's actually an extra on the Halloween Kills Blu-ray that is the kill count for Halloween Kills. He killed 31 people.
31? Holy shit.
Yeah. He killed 31 people in Halloween Kills.
Yeah. Trying to think of, like, anyone else. Was it Vince? Was the freaking douchebag?
I think so.
Okay, his death was also kind of lame.
The only thing that I liked, his was the one that was in, like, the parking lot, right?
Yes.
The only thing that I liked about his death was it was playing the, like, the song that's always associated with Scream. Oh my god, what's that song? Sorry, I gotta find the name of the song. Red Right Hand by Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know if they've played it in every single Scream movie, but I feel... whenever, I mean, I don't know if you recognized it, but whenever I see a Scream movie, or if I hear that song, I'm just like, yep, Scream. Always associate that song with those movies.
Yeah, I was not super familiar with that one.
It's a great song. I definitely recommend it.
Yeah, it was really good. It was, like, a really good way to use that song. Like, especially if it tied into previous films.
Yeah.
So, definitely a creative way to do that. I'm trying to think of... Oh! I really liked how they got to include, and I bet he loved it too, James A. Janisse.
Oh, yeah! He's from Dead Meat.
Yeah.
That was so cool.
That inclusion.
Yeah, like, dude. That gave me a little smile. I'm like, oh, dude, that's awesome.
Yeah, dude. I can't wait to hear him like talk about his experience with that.
Yeah, I know he's taking like a 2 to 3 month hiatus right now, just because he's going on his honeymoon with his wife.
Noise.
Yeah.
Oh, that's. But dude, like when I saw him, I'm just like, no way.
Yeah, if you guys haven't checked out his YouTube channel, Dead Meat, and watched the kill counts that he does for horror films, you guys are missing out on some incredible content. He's amazing at what he does.
Dude, how funny would it be if they gave him, like, the footage for, like, a full stab movie?
Dude, I actually always wanted to actually watch the stab films. Like, I really do. I would love to see all of them. I would binge watch that shit, not gonna lie.
Dude, it's funny because that's basically what Scream is. Like, it's seriously the same movies, just different title.
Well, wasn't it after Stab 3, they had to start going in their own direction with Ghostface because Sydney threatened to sue them for using her story.
Oh, that's right.
Because I want to see Stab... I can't remember if it's like Stab 5 or 6. Or maybe it's 4. Where Ghostface goes to space. I'm just like, yes, I want that in my life.
Yeah, but...
it can't be any worse than Jason X.
True that. But I feel like they did such a good job pulling this off. Like,
absolutely.
Like you said, I think we all had our doubts about it, but they just pulled it off like masterfully. Like the story's flow was really good. There weren't any parts that I can recall that were like boring.
No, dude, I was fully invested the whole time.
Yeah, they did so good at keeping like a really solid pacing, but also not going too quick. The only time I felt like they maybe went a little fast was with Sydney coming back.
Yeah, I will definitely agree with you on that one.
Yeah, other than that, like, I feel like they did really good. Like, they did really good character management. I really liked how they didn't put the original characters, like, too far into the spotlight.
Yes.
Like, they definitely focused on the new cast members, which was great. They gave us a really decent main character to follow in Sam.
Yeah, she was, I loved her. Yeah, both the sisters were great. Great characters.
Yeah, freaking... We'll get into it with acting, but I thought they did amazing. But everyone else, like, was super freaking solid. Like, the whole thing was just solid. And
yeah, that's the best way to explain it.
Yeah. But... Jeez, like, it's hard for me to, like, dock this for anything.
Yeah, like, dude, seriously, though.
I went into it thinking that I was going to give Scream, like, in somewhere, like, because, like, any typical Scream movie, I would put in, like, the low 80s, maybe high 70s. Like, other than, like, maybe Scream 4, because I really love Scream 4.
Oh, that is still my favorite one.
Yeah, so I think, like, Scream 4, I'd put at, like, 85, but I feel like this is better than that. Like, this might be my new favorite.
That's fair. I don't blame you.
So, with that being said, I think I would... Okay, I'm going to be, like, extra nice this go-round because I am going to be pretty harsh later.
Okay.
So, I'm going to... go to a 94 with story.
Wow.
It was good. It was so good.
Let's put the... No, never mind. That would spoil last week's episode. Never mind.
Wait, what were you thinking?
No, I was going to say, let the record show that Caleb's story grade for Scream is higher than his story grade for Encanto.
Okay, but I had to... Listen. Before you guys start judging me...
I'm not judging. I
have legitimate issues with Encanto's story. I mean, this one, yes, it does freaking kind of hurt me a little bit to put Scream higher, but it was so good. It was so good. And like I said, I had so little problems with it. If I could nitpick anything, I would. And I'm going to have to nitpick in other aspects.
No, yeah, dude, that's fair.
It's just this one was so freaking hard.
I hate to say, I'm definitely not as high as you are. Just because
that's fair.
Because I still feel Scream 4 is my favorite. I do like Scream 4 more than this one. But this is a great fifth movie. So I would put like Scream 4 in the 90s, like probably like 90, 92. So I'm going to give Scream, let's go on 89.
All right, and that brings our story grade or story score to a 91.5.
All right.
Which I do feel better about because Encanto is still higher. But yeah, like, I have this, like, this tally or, like, this mental tally in my head where every movie starts at, like, all hundreds, right?
Yeah.
And then every issue that I have brings it down, like, little by little by little. until it, like, we eventually get to where it's at. But this one, it's like it story wise, it just did not. I could not dock it for anything.
That's fair. That's
like it was not
fair.
A perfect 100 because horror movie, but it was up there.
I just want to argue that there are some horror movies that a lot of people, at least I feel, would actually put at 100. Halloween.
Okay. No. And I do agree. I do agree that there are some horror based stories that are like perfection.
Halloween.
And
all right, that's the last time I make that joke.
But yeah, this one, it just wasn't quite 100 for me. But it's very difficult for me to nitpick. Very difficult.
Fair enough.
Like, honestly, I feel like this, like, anything that I consider slow was when they were in, what's it, probably the twins' house. And,
oh, okay.
Like, talking to Dewey.
Yeah.
Other than that, like that's probably what I docked for. That's why it's not, like, at 100.
Okay, all right.
But I will be docking for other shit, so.
Okay. All right.
All right, so like I said, 91.5 for story. Moving on over to writing. I do believe I had some issues here.
I did too. Well, okay, so I want to say so I have two lines. One is one of my biggest positives of this movie, and the other one is like something that I don't know why it just kind of rubbed me the wrong way. I just didn't like how it came out. Like, for some reason, the line sounded better to me in the trailer. So the line that I did not like is when Dewey first calls Sydney and says, oh, you know, it's happening again. Do you have a gun? And in the trailer, Sydney says, I'm Sydney Prescott. Of course I have a gun. But in the movie, she says, I'm Sydney fucking Prescott. Of course I have a gun. I don't know why her adding the fucking part just kind of ruins it for me. I would have preferred just her saying, I'm Sydney Prescott. Of course I have a gun.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'm not the only one.
No, like, I do feel like that was a bit excessive.
It was a little too much. I'm like, okay, you know, I get it. You know, you're the final girl like Laurie Strode. I get it. Little too much for me, though.
Yeah. Dude, my favorite line comes from Dewey.
Okay.
And I'm willing to bet you probably know the line I'm talking about.
I don't know. I mean, I haven't seen this movie since opening weekend, so like I've forgotten some lines, but I'm sure I'll remember it when you tell me.
Yeah, so it's when they are in the house with, or in the twins' house, and they're trying to discuss like a game plan regarding the killer and everything. And so Dewey's like revealing, like, it's always someone within the tight knit friend group. And talking about like motives and everything. And then Wes, or who was it? I think it's Mindy, is starting to talk about, oh, like, you have your legacy characters, you have your new characters. And it's like, like, if you're trying to divert expectations, maybe it's like a legacy character. And so Wes looks over at Dewey and he's like, so maybe you're the killer. And Dewey's like, oh, really? Like, what's my motive? And then he starts listing off all the things that's going wrong in Dewey's life. And he's like, well, maybe you're the murderer, because that cut deep.
Oh, yeah.
Oh my gosh, I lost my mind with that. I
that like, was a
just
great scene.
Just like, he, because he sounded like he was gonna start crying, and like, just thinking about that line gets me going. It's thought it was so good.
Favorite line for me, and this just really added to the movie, just made it great. And this actually is also my favorite kill, is when Dewey unfortunately gets killed. The ghost face literally stabs him in the gut, and then takes another knife to his back and literally freaking guts him, just straight up. And he says to him, "It's an honor," before Dewey falls over dead. Just saying that to a legacy character, I'm just like, that is so badass.
It was pretty sick.
Yeah. Because I was telling Caleb this earlier. I'll fully admit, you know, like if I was came back as like a well-known killer and I get to kill someone that someone that was involved with the original massacre, I'll fully admit, yeah, that would be an honor if you got to take him out.
Dude, straight up.
Not that I'm, you know, psycho. By the way, be sure to check out episode 1 of the Gacy Gazette.
Hell of a way to plug that.
Right? I was thinking, you know what, I was going to do it at the end of the episode, but you know what, I feel since I talked about that, you know, no better time. So yeah, guys, episode 1 is now up. Tune into episode 2 next month. This month. Yeah, this month. Episode 2. It's going to be exciting.
Yeah, you better get on that.
Yeah, I mean, I've seen that episode at least 3 times, so I'd say probably at least another 3 where I can really, you know, dive into it.
Sweet. I think my biggest writing issues came from a lot of the extras. The biggest one for me was the sheriff. The new sheriff.
Oh, Judy?
Wes's mom. Yeah. She just... A lot of weird shit.
She like, is, I feel, I don't know why it felt like... She is a completely different character to me than she was in Scream 4.
I forgot she was in Scream 4, to be completely honest with you.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, she was the one that Gale kept thinking that she was hitting on Dewey. Because she was offering him, like, her lemon squares. She always wanted to be with Dewey on cases or some shit like that.
Okay, I'm vaguely remembering that.
Okay.
Yeah, so it's just... With her, like, the way that she was, like, borderline attacking Sam, and it, like, that felt really odd. Like, you're an adult.
It's like, yeah, and a like sheriff a real at adult. That.
Yeah, like, freaking chill.
Yeah.
And then everyone else, like, and so that she felt weird, and then I feel like the friend group, so Sam and Tara, who are the main two people, were excellent. The tight-knit friend group, so Mindy, Chad, Liv, and Amber, they felt very weird. Like, almost like, why would these people be friends?
Dude, yeah, like, straight up. Like, and you know, I know friends are assholes to each other, you know, jokingly. I mean, hell, that's, like, one of the main reasons why, you know, we're still bros. but, I don't know, I feel like since, just since we have, like, the friendship really wasn't established that well, if I was in that friend group, I'd be like, screw you guys. Like, how the hell am I still friends with you?
Well, it felt odd. Like, so, Sam technically wasn't part of the friend group. She had babysat for everyone in the friend group.
Yes.
So, the friend group was Tara, Wes, Mindy, Chad, Liv, and Amber. Tara and Amber were, like, besties. Wes was kind of I feel like the one that kind of had a secret crush on Tara.
Yeah. Yeah, I would definitely agree with that.
Or a not-so-secret, because I think Mindy was the one that called it out. Mindy and Chad were brother and sister. Like, their connection, like, whatever. But Chad was, like, a jock, and Mindy was just kind of like a big movie buff. And then Liv was just kind of like a weird semi-gothic character. that was all up in Chad's business.
Yeah, I mean, this group of friends is like nothing compared to, you know, what we got in the original.
Yeah, like, it made sense. Like, everyone was, like, into movies. Like, that was, like, a common factor between all of them. Like, yeah. It was very difficult to find, like, a common factor between these friends.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like Tara, Amber, and Mindy would have, like, been a pretty good friend group alone. Then Wes, Chad, and Liv would have been kind of like separate from them, and I would only say Wes is separate because he has like some sort of romantic connection towards or feelings towards Tara.
I thought it was Sam.
No, he likes Tara.
Oh, it's Tara? Oh, sorry.
Yeah, Sam's the older sister.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, so that's why, like, how I would view it. So, yeah, but it kind of felt like they were trying to pull a whole, like, everyone's friends thing, and it just did not feel right.
Yeah, it did not.
Yeah, so a lot of their interactions, once they started talking about their suspicions on who the killer might be, got funky. Like, got really, like, yeah. Just actually not odd, it got annoying, like, just the way they're like, oh, like, you could be the killer, like, I, like, and it was maybe it was like more a delivery issue.
Like, do you feel that way with when it's Amber was the one of the killers, right?
Yes.
When she's in the basement. Yeah, the basement with that one girl when she goes to get another beer.
Yes.
Is it kind of, yeah. I'll fully admit, yeah, that writing in that scene was kind of weird. This is like, oh, well, don't you know you never come down to the basement alone, you know? The killer could have just sneaked up on you. And the girl's just like, well, then how do I know you're not the killer? And it's just a back and forth, and I don't know, I feel, like, don't get me wrong, like, it could have been a really good scene. I just feel the writing could have been better.
Yeah. Just maybe a little bit better. I feel like, I don't know, like, I'm wondering if they could have revealed, like, done the reveal then with Amber. Probably not, though. I feel like my problem with, like, just the Scream series in general is, like, I feel like you'd almost need three killers to pull off the shit that they do.
Honestly, I kind of wish that, like, the killers are identified, like, literally back-to-back in every movie. I kind of wish that it was spread out. Like, I agree. I actually think it would have been a really cool idea if it was showcased that Amber was one of the killers right then and there in the basement.
Yeah, like, because I they had me fooled for, like, a second when they were down there having that conversation, and Amber's like, well, how do I know you're not the killer? And Mindy says, maybe, like, I am the killer. And I was like, oh, like, no, they didn't. And then turned out being fake, and I'm like, shit.
Like, I would have loved if, like, maybe, like, they start laughing, like, they start, you know, just laughing it off, and then all of a sudden Amber just stabs her in the stomach.
Yeah, or doing the, like the whole, when they were heading upstairs, and Mindy's like, all right, let's go back upstairs, and then, like, Amber stops, and she's like, you first. Like, that would have been a great time to reveal that she was a killer.
Yeah.
Oh, because yeah, the only one that went downstairs after her was Richie.
Yeah, that's true.
So I think that would have been, like, freaking perfect.
Yeah, dude. Oh, I absolutely agree.
But I love that. I love the twist of, or not even, what kind of a twist of Sam being Billy Loomis's daughter. and kind of being haunted by him. Like, it, I feel maybe that part was a little weird.
Like, that's why was she being haunted
by him?
Yeah, I mean, I feel for the most part, at least to me, what they set up, they pulled off pretty smoothly, pretty well.
Yeah, I think one of the, like, a big issue that they had was when Sam revealed to Tara about her, like, real father and why their dad left the family. When they did that, I feel like Tara's reaction was a little bit much.
That's fair.
Because, like, thinking about this chronologically, I would assume that Sam is, let's say, 23. Like,
sounds about right.
In that range, right?
Yeah.
And Tara is, I would say, a junior in high school.
It's like 17?
Yeah, 16, 17.
Yeah.
So if you go back to the time where Sam found out, she was 13. So that would put Tara at about 7 or 8, if I'm doing my math correctly.
Yeah, so, that sounds right to me. So yeah, she would definitely be old enough to definitely understand what that means and what's going on. I don't know, maybe I just come from a kind of household. That kind of stuff. Like, yeah, I kind of had to learn that kind of stuff very quickly, very young.
Yeah, so it's like when she's like, I don't understand why you didn't, like, come to me. You were 7. Like, seriously? I'm going to go to my 7-year-old sister and be like, hey, my dad's a serial killer? We could have handled it together. Pff, bet you couldn't have. Like that, like, it felt like a really odd reaction. Like,
I'll fully admit,
like,
when
I'll
she
say,
like,
why didn't you tell me sooner? Like, I could have totally bought that. Like, but her being like, why didn't you tell me back then?
Yeah, I agree. And then, like, bitch. Yeah, and then her screaming, "Get out, get out!" I'm like, okay, whoa.
Yeah, so let me, like, do the math, like, because if we're saying, like, 23. And we're saying she's 16. That's a 7-year difference. So, I'm sorry. She would have been 6.
Oh, yeah, that's even worse.
That is so much worse. Yeah. I'm not telling a 6-year-old that I just found out that my dad is not, or that person who I thought was my dad is not really my dad. Like, are you kidding me? I wouldn't, like, you can't even tell 6-year-old Santa's not real.
That's true. I mean, if you want to, yeah, that's true.
I sure hope we don't have any kids that listen to this.
Oh, God, dude, I hope not either.
I'm trying to think of, like, if anyone that I know or that we know would listen to this with,
dude,
a child
literally
in the
only
car.
People that I know that actually, like, listen to this on, like, a weekly basis is Sam. Sammy's dad.
Yeah, so I'm pretty sure he's in on the secret.
If you're not, I'm so sorry, Sam.
Vic listens to this while he's working.
Oh yeah, I forgot about
that. Do know he has a child in his life.
And DJ. Oh shit, okay.
Yeah, so I doubt he's going to listen to it with him in the car.
Okay, good. Considering I've said the F word, like, 3 times on this episode.
and then, DJ has a couple kids. I doubt he will listen to this with kids in his vicinity, so I think we're good.
Okay. Okay, good.
Yeah. Then... Yeah, I'm pretty sure we're good. I'm pretty sure we're good.
Dude, have you seen... Sorry, really quickly, off tangent. Have you seen the video going around? I don't even know if it's going around, of like this priest that walks into a mall during Christmas time, and literally to a line, like a line of kids that are lining up to go see Santa and sit on his lap, he shouts out, "Santa's not real, kids. The only reason for Christmas is God. You got, you know, come unto Christ. Santa's not real. You've been lied to this whole time." Like, dude, you're a piece of shit.
I would freaking.
You are a piece of shit. Yeah, dude. I'm sure a lot, dude. I wish parents would have done it, because he's a piece of shit.
I would, like, I'd be that one parent that got out of line, freaking knocked his ass out, and no one would tell on me.
Oh yeah, no.
Like,
literally, just announced. Well, now that we're over that nonsense, I don't know what he was saying.
Freaking tackle him, choke him out, and be like, "It's Krampus, run!"
There we go. Yep, it's one of Krampus's workers. Kids, don't listen to him.
Funny
dude,
what that
dude honestly, you could actually play that off.
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, as long as you've established Krampus when your kids are younger. Oh, yeah, dude, you could totally play that off.
That'd be hilarious.
Yeah.
Dude, I will freaking beat the shit out of anyone who ruins that for my daughter.
Oh, yeah, dude.
Or just my kids. Just my kids in general. Like, if you ruin Santa for my children, I will kill you.
Dude, yeah. Yeah, for anyone that ruins, to me, I just always feel so bad when a kid has to learn that Santa isn't real from someone who isn't their parents. I feel that's so sad. Sorry, not just parents, legal guardian.
Yeah, story time.
Oh God,
Coy learned that Santa wasn't real at school.
Aw, Coy.
Now, granted, Coy was 15.
Aw, poor Coy.
But which is kind of shitty when you think about it, because he was in a special ed English class.
Oh, that's where he found out?
Yeah. So he was in an English class, and the assignment was, I want you to write about when you found out Santa wasn't real. And Coy raised his hand and was like, but Santa is real.
I feel bad for laughing.
I know. dude, I laugh every single time I tell that story. But he came home and he was just like distraught. And then,
okay, first of all, fuck that teacher.
Yeah, I know, right? And and so we came home, and my mom felt like she had to sit all of us down and have the Santa conversation with us. Like, I already
you and Coy are 2 years apart, right?
I already knew. Bronson already knew, so it was just Coy.
Okay. Well, no, I can't. You and Coy are, is it 1 or 2 years apart?
2 years.
2 years, and then you and Bronson are
4 years.
4 years. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So you were 17 then?
Yes.
Okay.
It actually might have been. You might have been younger. Not much. Like, I think I was 16, then Coy would have been 14, and then Bronson was 12. But Bronson already knew.
Okay. I don't know about you. Oh, sorry, go.
No, like, what were you saying?
No, I was going to say, I don't know about you, but, like, going off, like, the prompt the teacher gave Coy in the class, don't, like, you know, of course, you know, when you're, when you find out, it's like, okay, yeah, Santa isn't real. I'm sorry, I don't really like to remember the exact moment I found out Santa wasn't real.
Yeah.
I don't remember that shit, and I don't want to.
I remember when I kind of pieced it together.
Let me guess, was it the writing on the presents? That was kind of it for me.
It actually was the same time I figured out the Tooth Fairy wasn't real.
Oh, damn, a double hitter.
Yeah, so this is what, like, this is what happened. I pieced together that Tooth Fairy wasn't real, and then I was like, I kind of sat there, and I'm like, okay, Tooth Fairy, super magical. Who else is on that team? And I was like, okay, Easter Bunny, probably not real. And then it's just like, I worked my way up to Santa, because, like, Santa was, like, the biggest one. I was just like, there's no way, like, there's no way he's real. Like, shit. But what happened was I lost a tooth, had it under my bed or under my pillow, and I woke up in the morning and like kind of like just reached my hand there and it was still there. And then I like, and so, and then I went back to bed, and then I kind of woke up. And because I felt, and then like I woke up and my dad was kind of like hovering over me, and then he was like, like I felt his hand under my pillow, and I like woke up and looked at him, and he's just like, hey, it's time to wake up, and then he like left. Then I reached under and there was money, and I was just like, And I was like, giving my dad the side
what's
eye.
What's going rest. On?
Yeah, I gave my dad the side eye like the rest of the night. Or the rest of the day.
Oh my god, I love
He honestly probably could have gotten away with it had he just hidden. Like, had he freaking just, like, ducked down or something, probably wouldn't have, like, thought about it twice.
Okay.
But it was just the fact that I was just, like, I woke up and saw him and felt, it was the fact that I felt his hand and saw him. If it would have been, I just saw him or I just felt his hand, I probably would have believed in the Tooth Fairy for a good couple more years.
How old were you?
It's like 9.
Okay. Damn it, I'm sorry. That just sucks that it was a double hitter for you.
Dude, it was like a shit ton of hitters.
Yeah.
Because it was just like, okay, Tooth Fairy. And then I started logicking.
I think that's the word.
I started to logic my way out of the Easter Bunny, and then like slowly like logic my way out of Santa. And I was just like, that no, sucks.
That
And like I was cool about it. I didn't tell my parents about it. So I don't know when they believed I stopped believing in Santa.
Okay.
But it was like 9.
Okay. All right.
I had like a little glimmer of hope that Christmas, like just a little bit, and then like it just like the pieces weren't adding up, and I was just like, shit.
One of the biggest things that kind of led me to like kind of really think, okay, is Santa really real? Was when we were living in California and in La Mita, we didn't have a chimney. So I'm like, okay, the only way that he would be able to get in is if he climbed through the kitchen window. And that's right above the sink. And I would assume that there'd probably be dishes in there, so he would make a racket and it would wake us up. So I'm just like, that's kind of when I started to question it.
Didn't the... Honestly, we didn't have a... Well, okay. We didn't have a chimney either. My dad always said that he just let Santa in.
Oh. Yeah, my parents never told me that. Which they should have. Yeah, I would have believed that.
Like, yeah, we don't have a chimney. He just comes to the front door. Like, I would so easily believe that.
Like, honestly, yeah. Like honestly,
I did.
Like,
even... I fell for it for...
Dude,
forever.
Especially considering how small that kitchen window was, I was like, there's no way he's fitting his bag through that. But then at the same time...
He can fit it through a chimney?
Okay, you know what? Fair enough. Because we can think of, like, the freaking Santa Claus, how literally he can just squeeze his ass just straight on through.
Gosh, that was a fun tangent.
Yeah, that was fun. Back to Scream. Anyway,
yeah, back to Scream. And back to writing. With the issues that I had and not liking a lot of the extras, but really enjoying the lines that the legacy characters got and the two new main characters.
Yes.
I think I'm going to be about an 82.
I think I'm going to go, well, you know what? I'm going to match you. I'm going to go an 82 as well.
Hell yeah. All right, so that averages us out to an 82. Next up, we got acting. So, going with who I'm assuming we all scored, we have Neve Campbell, who played Sydney Prescott, Courtney Cox, who played Gail Weathers, David Arquette, who played Dewey Riley, Melissa Barrera, who played Sam Carpenter, Jack Quaid, who played Richie Kirsch, Jenna Ortega, who played Tara Carpenter, Mikey Madison, who played Amber Freeman, Dylan Minnette, who played Wes Hicks, Jasmine Savoy Brown, who played Mindy Meeks Martin, Mason Gooding, who played Chad Meeks Martin, and then Sonia Amar, who played Liv McKenzie. Then I'll just include these two just because. Then Marley Shelton, who played Sheriff Judy Hicks, and then Skeet Ulrich, who played Billy Loomis. Alright, going off this, who's your top three? Unless they're all the legacy, then I'll say top five. I'll go top five, just because okay. We have three legacy.
Yeah, that's true. Number one, I would give to Sam. I thought she was great. Two, oh my god, what's her sister's name again?
Tara.
Yeah, two I would give to Tara. Three I would give to Dewey. I feel out of the three legacy characters, I feel he had the most to do. And I loved him in this movie. Four, you know what, four I'll give to, oh my god, Sydney, Neve Campbell. And then five I will give to... Who would I give to number five? Did I really like? The twin sister. What's her name?
Mindy?
Mindy. Yeah, I don't know what it is. Don't get me wrong, Courtney Cox was really good as Gail in this once again. But I don't know, she just didn't stand out to me that much.
That's honestly fair. She did not have as much to do as the other. Like, she was, I feel like she was just there to tell Sydney that she died.
She was kind of there just because it's like, well, you can't bring back just Sydney and Dewey. You have to bring back Gail, too.
Yeah. Interesting top five, though. My number one, I'm going to give to Richie.
That's fair. He was great.
Jack Quaid was incredible. Dude, he's such a good actor.
He really is. Like, oh my god.
And he does so much stuff. Like, he does voice acting. Like, he's acts in, like, super violent shows. Like, and movies, I guess. This movie.
Yeah, I was going to say, like this movie?
Yeah, but he also does, like, kids shows. He does rom-coms. Like, there hasn't been a single thing that he's been in that I haven't liked.
That's awesome.
Like, shit. I'm looking at all this. Yeah, I'm looking at his IMDb page. Yeah, he's done some really good stuff. And I feel like his, like, standout was in The Boys. That's when he, like, really became, like, prominent.
I've never seen that, so.
Really good. Really good if you get
that, it. That's what I've heard. It.
It's just kind of like an R-rated Justice League.
All right, yeah,
but I'm sold. Better.
Okay, I like it. Yeah, I'm sold.
Yeah, it's kind of like if like an R-rated Justice League and following the team of normal people that are trying to kill them.
Okay, I like it.
Yeah, but he does like a lot of like voice work and just like a bunch of different stuff. Like, he's such a good actor. He was in The Hunger Games. Like, that was one of his first roles.
Oh my god, yeah, he was Marvel from District 2, right?
Yep. Yeah. But yeah, like, are you kidding?
Yeah, I knew I recognized his face. Okay, yeah, that's what I recognize him from.
Yeah, and his parents are Dennis Quaid and Meg Ryan. So he has some freaking good
acting. That's awesome.
Legacy behind him.
Dude, yeah, no kidding. That's badass.
Yeah, but him, like, he did a really good performance. Like, he made me question my decision on whether it was him a lot. And that, like, the only reason that I, like, suspected him from the get-go was... Actually, it wasn't even the get-go. I didn't start suspecting him until Dewey said, like, how long have you known him? And she's like, 6 months. I'm like, oh. It's him. But, yeah, so, it, like, and he just kept making me question whether it was real. I'm like, there's no way that they're going to do the boyfriend again. And then, like, they would just do, like, just these little things. Like, the way that he was, like, watching all of the Stab movies. I'm like, that's mighty suspicious and super inappropriate.
Yeah.
So, like, yeah, but he, like I said, made me question it, like, a lot, way up until the end of the movie. Like, I had such a hard time putting him as, like, my final suspect. Like, I thought it was going to be Liv and Amber, because I was suspicious from Amber from, like, the beginning.
Yeah, that's fair.
So... Yeah, so loved him, loved his performance, and even when he started going, like, super crazy at the end, it wasn't, like, overdone.
Like Amber?
Yeah, Amber was a lot. And the way that she died, first off, how in the ever-living shit did she catch fire so quick?
You know, like, fair enough.
Did they, like, dump her with, like, oil or something that I missed? Because she seemed extremely flammable.
She did. Yeah. Yeah. I'll have to watch this movie again to see.
Yeah, I was just like, I had to have missed something. Like, she just, like, immediately.
Yeah. She lit up like a freaking Christmas tree.
Yeah. And then, like, when she goes freaking running with her burnt face, I'm like, that's bullshit.
Yeah. Once again, anyway. Little too much.
Yeah, a little too much. Yeah, so Richie's my number one. My number two, I'd actually give to Tara. like, Jenna Ortega, dude, she is an up-and-comer.
Oh, yeah. She really is.
Dude, you know who I would love to see her play? If she looked a little older? I would love to see her play Black Cat in the MCU.
Ooh.
I think she would do such a good job.
Yeah, I'm liking that quite a bit.
Yeah, my only problem with that is that she looks young. But she would do incredible.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with that.
Yeah, so I would give it to Tara, my number two. Number three, I'd have to give to Dewey. I thought he slipped back into the role damn near flawlessly.
Yeah, absolutely agree.
Like, he gave the humor that I have come to expect from Dewey as a character, but also has a level of wisdom that he hasn't had in previous iterations. And so it's just seeing that growth of character was really nice, and he played it off so well. And number four, I'm going to give to Sam. I think she did really well for a leading lady. I don't know if this is her first time being a lady. Let's see. Oh, not quite. She was Vanessa in the Heights.
Oh my god, she was. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. Her acting was way better in this movie than it was in the Heights.
Absolutely.
And I think that, I don't think that's her fault. I think it's how her character was written.
Very much so. Very much so. So, yeah, she did an incredible job this go around. Like, played all the scenes bit. I think maybe a little on the dry side.
If that's fair.
I had any complaints about her, it'd be that. But other than that, she did really well. And then last, I'd have to give it to Sydney.
Yeah, Neve Campbell definitely came back and made the character her own once again.
Yeah, she came back with a vengeance, too.
Yeah, absolutely.
I would say my only problem isn't necessarily with her. Like, it's her and Gale got stabbed and shot.
That's true.
So it's just like the way that they were just like standing and like perfectly fine, like not, no one came to check on them in the freaking ambulance.
Yeah, whereas when she gets stabbed in Scream 4, you could definitely tell that she's affected. Yeah, that she's affected.
Yeah, so other than that, like, great performance. What kills this movie for me is the extras.
Yeah, I can definitely agree with that.
They, like, Mindy and Chad were just, like, too stereotypical. Just, like, the movie buff and the jock, they're just too much. Liv was just, like, what in the actual hell?
I think I
get a read on her.
That's fair. I mean, I don't know. For me, I think I kind of like Mindy for the fact that she knew so much about, like, everything horror movies, from remakes to reboots to even just reboots in general that aren't even horror movies. Like, they actually bring up Ghostbusters Answer the Call in this movie. It's kind of weird, but, you know, it was cool.
Yeah.
So I think that's the fact alone as to why I liked her character so much.
Yeah. But, I mean, Liv, on the other hand, was just way too much. The way that, like, the interaction that Liv and Mindy had, where Liv was basically like, you know what happens to the expert, and, like, acting super, like, killer-like.
Yeah, like, I remember that.
I stopped, like, I had, like, some mild suspicions about her.
Yeah.
That were completely stomped out as soon as she started acting like that. I'm like, no, it's not her. Like, she's trying too hard.
Yeah, that's fair.
Like, and that's even, like, accepting the fact that Mindy was the next, like, targeted person.
Yeah, it's true.
Like, that, it just felt like I was, like, they were trying to trick me. And I'm like, yeah, not falling for your shit. And then Amber. Amber was fine, but she was just, like, super bitchy the entire movie.
Yeah, she was.
Like, she just was, like, upset at everyone, giving everyone a freaking hard time.
Dude, yeah, she was such a bitch to Sam. She's just like, oh, I know what's best for your sister. No, you don't.
First I can off, clearly say, you're a child.
Yeah.
And I'm like, and second off, you're a freaking bitch.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
Like, it almost didn't make sense why she was trying to, like, push Sam away. Because what if Sam just went away?
Yeah, that's true.
Like, it's super hard. Like, Richie, I could totally believe being, like kind of mastering this little scheme. Amber was a completely different story. I'm like, I don't know how the hell you thought you could pull this off.
Yeah. Yeah, I would definitely agree with that.
But yeah, and then I had my issues with the sheriff. Wes was just, like, such a small part of this movie that it felt kind of, like, no point for him to be there.
Which really sucks because, what's his name, Daniel?
Dylan.
Or, sorry, Dylan. Yeah, Dylan Minnette. Such an incredible up-and-coming actor, young actor, whatever. I seriously wish that he had a bigger role. I think he's such a great actor.
Yeah, he's pretty good. So it was kind of a shame to see him wasted here.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, I think I'm like a 78 for acting. I'm pretty low. And that's just because the extras brought it down that much.
Yeah. I think I'll go like a little higher. I'll go an 80.
Yeah, I told you my future scores were going to make up for that really high
score.
Yeah,
you weren't kidding. Like, god damn.
All right, next up we got logic. So did the movie follow its own rules?
I'd say so.
That's where I'm not sure they did.
Okay.
They set this in, like, a realistic world where you're... And I feel like the amount of damage that some people took and lived was too much.
You know, fair enough.
Like, okay, no joke. Watching this movie, I thought Wes was going to live.
Yeah, you know what? I thought the same thing.
Like, all the damage that everyone before him took and not died, I thought Wes was going to live, despite everything we saw.
Yeah. Because, like, honestly, thinking about that scene, how his mom is stabbed on the front lawn, or the front doorstep, whatever, and, you know, Ghostface just keeps stabbing her in her chest area. And the fact that she dies from... Wait, what?
No, I completely forgot about that.
Like, the fact that she... Wait, what?
I said, I have thoughts about that scene, so...
No, like, the fact that she dies from him or her... I forget who was in the Ghostface costume at that point. But the fact that she dies from Ghostface stabbing her multiple times, but yet Tara, at the beginning, does not die from Ghostface stabbing her multiple times. I don't know. That
dude, big problem. So Tara freaking called the cops. And the cops got there before she, like, actually died, right?
Yeah.
Her, the freaking sheriff called for units at her house immediately while she was driving to said house and somehow got stabbed to death in broad daylight.
Yeah, how the hell did no one come out and see this shit?
Are you kidding me? Like, my neighbors can't freaking water their lawn without me seeing them. So, her getting stabbed to death, and then Ghostface somehow had enough time to pull some weird Chucky shit on Wes.
Yeah.
Like, is the response time in that town that awful?
Apparently.
Woodsboro, excuse you, your PD boss don't give called shit. You. Like, you're telling me there was no one on patrol that could have gotten there within, like, a few minutes? Like, 5 minutes max. I probably could have ordered a pizza by the time it took the cops to get there.
Oh, shit.
In broad freaking daylight, dude. Like,
yeah.
What?
It's bullshit.
Like, it would have made sense for if they did, like, reverse. Like, if they killed Wes first and then killed the sheriff, then I probably could have accepted it a bit more. But it's just the fact that they had it so it was just, like, so long before they killed, or before Ghostface killed Wes.
Yeah.
Like, after A, stabbing Judy, like, in broad daylight, like, if you would have swapped that up, I probably would have believed you a bit better. But, yeah, that was my biggest, like, logic drop.
Yeah, along with the same for me.
Yeah, along with, like, people getting stabbed multiple times and living through it. Like, what's the kill count in this movie? Three?
It seems like it. Dude, honestly, Tara coming back from her stab wounds, I'm just like, okay, if we're going with that, even though he was actually, you know what? Maybe he was stabbed that many times. The freaking guy that Michael Myers drags over to the table and heaps him over and literally stabs like five freaking knives into him. Hell, he should still be alive.
Yep. That's exactly what I was thinking. I'm like, freaking Ghostface doesn't know how to go for the arteries.
No. He does not. I love Michael Myers just starts from the top and just goes down. He's like, okay, I'm bound to get it, you know, at some point.
Yeah. One thing that I really liked, that they did follow some sort of logic, was when they were going through, or when Tara was at the hospital and using the wheelchair, and you could, like the way that she was just, like, in pain, like, while rolling herself around, that was intense.
That was handled very, very well.
Yeah, and I love that, like, they showed shots of her hand as it started to bleed.
Yeah.
Like, oh my gosh. Like, that looked like it hurt.
Oh, yeah. Like, ugh.
Like, and I feel like that just, like, isn't a tribute to Jenna Ortega's acting ability, because she made it seem like it freaking hurt.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Like, honestly, my biggest complaints with this is just the shit that people survive.
Yeah.
Like, Mindy getting stabbed in the shoulder, completely get it. Yeah. Her brother getting stabbed in the back, no.
Yeah. I'm sorry, you ain't coming back from that.
Yeah, I'm not buying it.
Dude, I can't wait to see CinemaSins talk about like how people survive the deaths in this movie or the kills.
I know. I can't wait to see Dead Meat's video on this.
He'll add one. He's just like, "What? What the hell? That wasn't it. This is bullshit."
Dude, like the kill count, like from beginning to end, Tara got attacked, didn't die. Then it was the douchebag.
So that's one.
Vince. So, yeah, Vince is dead. Then who gets attacked after that? I'm pretty sure after that is the sheriff.
So, sheriff for some.
Yeah, sheriff and Wes die. All the friends are still alive. And then Amber and Richie die.
Oh, and Dewey.
Oh, and Dewey. And Dewey.
So, six.
That's not a super high kill count.
No, it's not. Dude, you didn't even make it into double digits.
Yeah. Like, you should have... You could have gotten away with killing a lot more people.
Yeah. Freaking pussies.
Yeah. Like, I would have killed Chad off. Or just had him die. Honestly, I probably would have killed Gale, too.
Oh, and like, leave Cindy as the sole survivor.
Yep.
No, fair enough.
I think there's just something poetic about that.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree.
I thought this movie was going to have the frickin' balls to kill Sydney.
You know what I was about to say, dude? I'm thinking Halloween Ends might have the balls to do that, but then I'm just like, wait, Halloween Resurrection kind of already did that, but in like the stupidest way possible. So, God, I hate how Laurie Strode dies in that movie. So much.
That movie was so bad. It is. Anyway, yeah, so, I mean, they did not do a good job at keeping true to, like, what damage kills people versus what damage doesn't.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, so that's very true.
Unfortunately for that, I'm pretty low too. Like I think I'm not like as low as like acting. I'm somewhere in like the writing area. Maybe like 84.
Yeah, you know what? I'm gonna agree with you.
Alrighty, that averages our logic category to an 84. Moving on over to effects. They were pretty solid in this.
Yeah. The practical effects looked freaking great.
I don't even know if they... Did they have any, like, special effects?
I don't think they did.
I didn't notice any. The only I can think of is the de-aging of Billy Loomis.
Yeah, and even that looked pretty good.
Yeah. So... I mean, everything looked freaking incredible.
Dude, yeah.
Like, all the kills looked incredible. They were brutal as all hell.
I can't remember. We talk about, like, if, like, we liked any, like, shots or anything with effects, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Like, effects kind of pulls in cinematography in a way, too, so.
Okay, cool. Because I know it's in the trailer, but that scene where Tara's, like, starting to crawl away from Ghostface, and you see him get up slowly and just start walking over to her. Such a badass scene. I just love the camera work. Just, oh, I love it.
Oh, hell yeah. Dude, speaking, like, if we're talking favorite shots, I freaking loved the shot when Sam realizes which house she's in.
Yes. Oh, dude, thank you for bringing that up. I totally forgot about that shot.
Dude, did you catch that at all? Or were you just as, like, shocked as I was?
No, dude, I was shocked too. Because I'm pretty sure, wasn't it repainted? I don't think it was the same colors from the original.
No, it wasn't same colors at all.
Yeah.
It like same layout and everything, and I was
when she did that, I'm like, oh my god, yeah, same staircase. I'm like, how the hell did I not pick up on this?
Dude, just that reveal. And like as it like it's zooming out like the front door and she's just standing like, oh my gosh.
Yeah, oh, such a great shot. Like what a great pan out. Oh, I love it.
Dude, like when Sydney freaking like when they were driving and they're like, where is she? And they saw on the map, I was like, oh, nuh-uh. Nuh-uh. And then they, like, yeah, my mind was freaking blown. I was like, oh, my gosh. Oh, like, so good. So good. Yeah, other, like, special effects. Other than the stabbings, there wasn't a whole lot of special effects, but no. Everything looked really good.
Yeah, blood looked really good.
Yeah, the DH Billy looked super good. I think I had a little bit of a problem. I didn't know who it was at first. Like, did you?
No, I mean, because I didn't even realize that it was the actual the original actor that they just de-aged him. I thought that it was a completely new actor that they had brought in to play Billy Loomis.
Okay. That's what I initially thought, too. Like, just after recording, I figured that out.
Okay, yeah.
But, yeah, so I didn't realize that was Billy at all. Like, until they said.
I feel the only way that like you kind of like really know it is him is like he's wearing like the classic white shirt that he had in the first movie and there's blood on it. I'm like, okay, yeah, that's Billy.
Yeah. So, other than that, I mean, I have no problems giving the effects a super high score.
Yeah, I don't either.
I'm going to go 95.
Yeah, I'll match that too.
Hell yeah, so our effects score is 95. Moving on over to music. I'll say, I feel like they did a really good job.
Yeah, I mean, of course the score was amazing. I feel the biggest thing that like jumped up to me was what I brought up earlier, them using the Red Right Hand song, which every time they use that in a Scream movie, it just makes me super happy. So yeah, that definitely raises it up for me.
Yeah, same here. The only thing that like it didn't have for me was a catchy song. Like, and I know that song just didn't resonate with me as hard as it did you.
No, that's fair. I mean, but, like, I feel like the Scream movies, sometimes they're, like, themes that they go with. Like, it's kind of hard to, like, really get stuck in your head. Whereas, you know, like, with Halloween, the classic theme song, like, you catch yourself, like, humming that.
Yeah. I think what was lacking with this... Actually, let me take that one back. In previous movies, Scream movies, what was lacking was, like, a solid track. Like, I feel like the use of music wasn't as good as it was in this one.
Okay.
So, I think for music, I'm, like, right on the border of giving it a 9, but I think I have to give it an 8. Like, it was really, really good. It was so good. But it's just the lack of soundtrack or the lack of, like, memorable song. But they...
I know, I'm on the same boat as you.
I'm going to give it a 9.
Damn, you're going to... Because I'm actually giving it an 8.
Are you really?
Yeah, I mean, like, even with the, you know, like, the classic Red Right Hand song, that's really the only thing that really stood out to me with the soundtrack. Don't get me wrong, it's good. But that's, like, the biggest thing that jumps out to me. And I don't know, I feel that's not worthy of a 9, but it's still worthy of a high grade with an 8.
Yeah. Well, that makes me feel a little bit better.
Okay.
Yeah, so that averages us out to an 8 because we round down.
Yes.
All right, moving on over to costumes. I think the biggest one was Ghostface, which you can't get Ghostface wrong.
No, and it looks just as great as ever. I love the Ghostface costume so much.
Yeah, it's just as haunting, too.
It is. Ugh.
Like, they do such a good job at making that, like, terrifying.
Yeah, they really do. So, I'm like, sorry. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I was just saying, like, it's just that... Like, the big freaking cloak, the combat boots, like, they just go crazy with that.
And it's just so iconic. I love it so much. So yeah, I'm sorry, I'm out of 10, just for Ghostface alone.
I'm at a 9.
That's fair.
Just, I understand. Just because, like, I'm taking everyone else's costumes into account.
Okay, no, so that's fair.
So yeah, I'm going to a 9, which would average us out to a 9.
Wait, I thought you were giving costumes a 9.
I am, but like just algorithm stuff.
Oh, okay.
Makes it easier than
that. Yeah, okay, yeah, that's fair. Sorry, I was. Confuse myself.
All right, last up, we got our own personal score for it. I'll take this one first. I want to hear your thoughts, just because you're more familiar with the other Scream movies.
Okay.
Or you've had longer to like dwell on them than I have.
No. I'm glad I was able to introduce you though to this franchise.
Oh yeah, such a good franchise. Just to start off, I think I'm sitting at an 87 for my personal score. I had a ton of fun with this movie. It was such a good sequel, exceeded my expectations tenfold. Probably my new favorite Scream movie. Like, I'd probably go 5, 4, 1. I forget which one's, like, the shitty one. Is it 3? Okay, yeah, so 5, 4, 1, 2, 3. That's my new Scream ranking. But, like, yeah, just the stuff that they were able to pull off. And, like, I feel like that's, like, a big thing right now is doing, like, what this one claims to be a requel. Like, because they freaking killed it with Ghostbusters Afterlife. And I feel like we've had, like, a bunch of other movies like this that... And they're just killing it. They are just killing it. Like, hitting all of the nostalgic notes that you'd want them to hit, including all the things you'd want them to include, and just giving us, like, a super killer, like, conclusion. Like, just so well done. So well done. So, yeah, with that, I'm giving it an 87.
All right. I am a little lower. I am giving it an 85. Yeah, I absolutely agree with everything Caleb says. One thing I will change is that this isn't my favorite Scream movie. I can completely understand why it is, because it is such a great sequel. Scream 4 is definitely still my favorite. I just love everything that one did. But this is definitely up there. Like, honestly, I feel my ranking would probably be 4, 1, 5, 2, 3. That's that's probably where I put it.
I might need to go back and rewatch them, because it's been a while. I haven't seen the other 4 since we watched them.
Okay,
so I probably should have gotten a refresher course.
Very good. I mean, honestly, I should have too. I can't remember. Did I send you the digital code for the first one at least?
I want to say yes, but I'm not sure it worked because I don't recall seeing that on my list.
Okay. I mean, I have another copy of it, so I'll send you that code as well. Just hopefully that one works. But yeah, super solid fifth movie. If this is the end, terrific ending. And if there is going to be a sixth one, I really hope it delivers as well as this one does. Because ever since from like 4 and 5 have been so good. And the fact that we came from Scream 3 to Scream 4 and 5 is, like, amazing in its own right for how great these last two movies have been. So, yeah.
Dude, I would love for them to continue this series. Like, I think
I would too.
I think the Scream franchise has a lot of... I mean, not, like, a lot, but it gives you, like, a decent enough sandbox to play in.
That's fair.
Like, following, like, a certain formula. But I do feel like you do get to that point where you can't do the crazy movie references anymore. Because very few movies have ever gone that long. Or series, just movie. Like, I think the only one you'd... Like, if you did a sixth one, I feel like the only thing you could compare it to is Harry Potter.
You know what? Fair enough.
Yeah, or anything like MCU related. Like there's nothing else to compare it to. Like you can't do the whole requel thing.
Yeah.
So I mean, unless you just wanted to like to start over from square one or whatever, but I feel like it'd be super hard to because of the Gale's decision to keep the killer's anonymous.
That's true.
Yeah, I just don't know where you'd take it that would make sense.
Yeah. Yeah, no. But, yeah, that's very true.
Like, I would be turned off to seeing that, though, so... To seeing a sixth one.
Yeah, no, I get you.
That's just because this one, like, was really good.
No, that's absolutely fair. But yeah, so 85 for me.
All right. Well, that averages our personal score to an 86. And that concludes this week's breakdown. So the final All Bros letter grade for Scream 2022 has come to a B+.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, so this is sitting at an 86.56%.
Not too shabby.
I'm surprised it got that high.
You know what? That's fair.
Yeah, it was very surprising for me. Like, I thought it was I knew it was going to do well. Just because it is a really good movie. I thought it was going to end up in the B range. So. All right. So this puts it. Yeah. So Scream 2022. At an 86.56%. Is. Below. Frozen 2. Which is at an 86.59. It is below. In the Heights. Which is at an 86.81.
Okay.
It's below Nobody, which is at an 87. It is also below Halloween from 1978, which is at an 87.06. And then finally, it is below Psycho, which is at an 87.10.
You know, honestly, thinking about it now, considering that we broke down the original Halloween, feel we should do the same thing with Scream.
I would be very down for that.
Hell yeah. Sweet.
Yeah, I'll put that on our list of like other movies to do.
Sweet. Cool.
And see if we can like squeeze it in somewhere.
Yeah.
All right. So now getting to what this is above.
Uh-oh.
There's going to be some problems. This puts it above The Lovebirds, which is at an 86.54.
Okay.
Puts it above The Lego Movie 2, which is at an 86.5. Puts it above Captain Marvel and Sing 2, which are both at an 86.25. And it puts it above Spider-Man Homecoming, which is at an 86.22.
Oh, Vic's going to kill us. He's going to perform his own Woodsboro massacre.
This is our second B-plus movie recently that scored above Spider-Man Homecoming.
Oh, shit, that's funny.
Yeah, and then just for shits and giggles, it's above Nightmare on Elm Street, which is at an 86.12%.
No offense to the original, but I can definitely agree with that.
Yeah. Okay. For those of you who want to throw a bitch fit over where this is placed, the difference between Scream and Spider-Man Homecoming is 0.3%.
Damn.
Yeah, Spider-Man Homecoming is at an 86.2, is at like an 86.2, where Scream is at an 86.5. It's seriously 0.3. Wow. Like, it's not even a full, like, even the bottom B-plus movie is not even a full percentage away.
Wow, damn.
Like, if I wanted to, let's see, there are 9 movies above Scream 2, or Scream, before you get 1% away.
Wow. Okay, wow.
Yeah, so, like, our margins, like, this is just, like, freaking breadcrumbs of, like, a difference. Like, just, like, they're so freaking mild. So, like, when people, like, anytime someone wants to, like, throw a fit, and I'm like, it's so funny because, like, they see the ranking and they're like, what, that's bullshit. And then I, like, show them, like, the score or the percentage, and they're like, well, I guess. Like, it's just, it's so, so tight. Like, I feel like we could just take out the, like, if we were just around these, it'd be a completely different ball game. But I'm not going to do that because I like the super tight percentages. Yeah, so that's where Scream 2022 is placed.
All right. Hell yeah. Well, I would say that concludes this week's episode. If you like what you hear, want to hear more, be sure to follow us basically wherever you listen to podcasts. We're on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, etc., etc. You can also catch all of our episodes on YouTube if that is your preferred listening spot. And be sure to follow us on all of our social media, where you can DM us with episode ideas, answer our questions of the week, all that fun jazz. Those are Facebook for facebook.com/TheAllBros, Twitter and Instagram at TheAllBros, and also TikTok. We are at TheAllBros. So, yeah, be sure to check out our TikTok.
I have seen the ones you've posted a couple times.
Hell yeah. Awesome.
They'll show up on my For You page here and there.
Dude, for a second, the one person that put, I think it's still one comment that posted on the previous video I posted. I didn't realize. Yeah. I was just like, okay, damn, that's so rude. So I was like, honestly, like, ready to just block him. But then I realized it was your dad. I'm like, okay. All right, fine. I'll keep Dave's comment.
Like, what else were we expecting?
Yeah, exactly. But you can also email us at theallboyschannel.com if you would prefer to get us your episode ideas or answer our questions of the week that way. You when can we post also, them. Yeah, when we post them. I love how we posted one and then we've gone like 2 weeks without posting another. But
I know, oh well.
Yeah, we'll get better. We promise. At least we hope so. If you want to check out our website, we are tinyurl.com/theallbros, where you can, if you would prefer to, get your merchandise that way, considering that's the best way to actually get the design that you want. Stupid companies taking down other designs by Caleb. So yeah, you can go there, fill out what you want, we'll get that made for you. But if you prefer to actually check out our official store, we are tpublic.com/user/theallbros channel. But I know Caleb is working on getting us moved to Teespring. So.
Yeah, it gets harder the more artworks I make.
Not to understand, man. No, dude, I applaud you for being able to keep up with this stuff. You're amazing.
Try.
Next week on the podcast, we'll be breaking down Ron's Gone Wrong.
Hell yeah.
I am so excited to see this movie, considering dude, this made Caleb's top 10 of last year. Yeah, dude, I can't wait to watch it. I'm so excited. So if you guys want to watch that, it is on Disney Plus right now. So
do it. Do yourself the favor. It is so good.
But yeah, that's going to conclude this week's podcast. Until next time, I am Jonathan.
Nah, I'm Caleb.
And we will see you guys next week. So long. I don't know why I stuttered so much.